So I met Samson more than 30 years ago, first time in Leningrad.
35,
right, and in Leningrad now, St. Petersburg, right, and we have a great, we have a close contact in Rutgers, 91, 92, right, a lot of discussions, a lot of, well, I learned a lot from Samson. It's a, actually many problems we discussed at the time. I'm still thinking about the problems, and fortunately some of them were solved, but...
We even wrote a paper.
Yeah, that was a great time, and it's my pleasure to participate this conference in honor of Samson, and I would like to thank the organizer for this great opportunity. Okay, I'm going to talk today about the recent work with my former grad student, Gleb Kataousov, and I'm going to discuss the certain aspect of integrable quantum field theory. So, and this sound, integrable quantum field, conformal field theory sound, actually it's a little bit strange, because in general, a conformal field theory doesn't leave many integrable structures. Well, conformal structure, maybe some extended conformal symmetries, but I would focus on some additional input, which sometimes possible to introduce for the conformal field theory. So here is the outline of my talk. First, I discussed most of the time of this would be kind of introduction. Discuss the integrable structures. What does it mean? At least what's meaning of this? And then we, among the problem which occurs in studies integrable structures, problem of degenization of certain set of commuting operators, usually integrability. We have a commuting set, infinite commuting set of operators, and the problem is how to diagonalize it, how to construct the common spectrum. The central subject of my talk is reflection operators, and that can be introduced in many integrable, in many conformal field theory, but we will focus on some particular simplest situations of so-called KdV integrable structures for conformal field theory. Well, and some application, maybe a few words. All right, so let me start with a rather general introduction. So we are considering that we are doing the two-dimensional integrable quantum field theory at this point. So, so integrability means the existence of the continuity, infinite number of continuity equations of these forms, the T, it's the tensor densities, since we are in two dimensions, that makes sense to introduce the, use the Lorentz invariance, introduce the light cone variables in Euclidean versions, the galomorphic and galomorphic coordinates, and then these equations, continuity equation, because somewhat simpler. So this is local equations, but assuming the certain periodic boundary conditions imposed in the system, simplest setup, it's just a system with the space coordinate computified on the circle radius r. So the our world sheet geometry is just a cone, just a cylinder. Right, then having these continuity equations, assuming that the density are periodic functions along the space directions, then clearly the such a combination, such integrals taken over the time slice would be integral of motion. They are conserved. You can freely move the integration contour along the cylinder, right, and they will not change the value of such an integral. So this is integral of motions, but this is not enough for integrability, because having at hand just a classical Liouville integrability, it makes sense to require that this operator mutually commute, right? But this picture works for conformal field theory. But now the idea is, let's assume that the ultraviolet behavior of this conformal field theory controlled by the certain conformal field theory. So originally we have a theory with the correlation length, let's say, with the mass, and then consider the limit. So the only dimensional parameters here, and the problem is length is the size of the cylinder measured in the unit of correlation length. So we assume that this dimensional parameter goes to zero. Then the equations, original equations, this one, the conservation equations, turns out to the condition for condition that the fields T and this density became galomorphic in this limit because the left hand side actually vanished in this limit. So, and we end up with a set of Riemann, Cauchy-Riemann equations for the densities and for the densities to the infinite set of densities S would labels the S plus one, it's a Lorentz spin of the density. All right, and this way, these equations are rather actually shows that the infinite number of integral of motions. If, for example, we expand from these conditions, assuming that the T is periodic functions, we can expand in the Fourier modes, right? And these conditions mean that all expansion coefficients actually integral of motion. So a lot of integral of motion we can build this way, but they are not commute. Nevertheless, we can construct the commuting family by taking the limit again. Taking the limit of the integral of motion from conformal field theory, quantum field theory, and to consider the limit, we get something which would be not only consort but also commuting. All right, and in these situations, the problems in this way becomes rather well mathematically well-defined problem. The problem of finding the common spectrum of these operators. I call it local integral of motions, local because we have integrals over the local densities. And this operator, since the conformal field theory can be the space of states of conformal field theory classifies in terms of reducible representations of the conformal algebra, Virastor algebra, maybe other algebra of extended symmetry, then this operator can be thought as operator acting representations of such an algebras, and the problem of degeneralization such an operator becomes well-defined, a mathematical problem can be formulated just in a problem in representation theory for such an algebras. And
sir, how did you define IS there?
IS?
The next one.
This one?
No. It's anti-holomorphic in the Z part, and it is holomorphic in Z. So how?
Yeah, our starting point was the integral of motions, and this limit of this integral of motions you have in the limit when s when the correlation length goes to zero, it became the conformal integrals. So this is a formula. Just that this part actually in the integral is disappeared. It's proportional to the in the massless limit, and only we end up only the integral like this. So
I didn't understand this. This equation. How does it give the second integral of motions?
You see, since we have we assume the P invariance, we can always replace Z by Z bar. So clearly, if you have this series with this integral of motion, that you can always flip the directions, so space directions, which is replace the spin by minus spin of the Lorentz spin. So that okay. So that is the. Let me just basic example would be the Singe-Gordon model. So this is classical. This model, the actions given by this famous formula, and this is classical integrable systems. It's a massive theory. The correlation length related to the parameter mu in front of the cost. And well, classically, there's a set of local integral of motions of the form we discussed just where local densities on even local densities, even spins. They are commutes, and this formula, all this formula has a classical analog, and then quantize, can be quantized. The simplest, so the sum of the first non-trivial integral of motion, E1 in E1 bar, gives the Hamiltonian, and the difference is at moment. All right, so that is an example, and now the questions we, so this is, the theory is massive, but the questions, we are interested in the conformal limit, and this is a little bit tricky, because we, well, the mu seems to be small, right, in the limit when correlation length goes to zero, then length goes to infinity, that mu became small. In the first glance, we can neglect these terms and have a free theory, but it's not quite true because this potential is unbounded.
There is in kind of the hand, the two, so one. From the R, and there is a hand. Can you move
one
the hand?
One question, but can you move mouse?
Ah, okay. Yes. It's hidden, right? Yeah, nothing. This is not secret. No, any secret. It's hidden by this. All right. But that's not quite true because in the configuration space of the theory, so when there is a domain, right, or the field phi becomes large, and it doesn't matter what small you choose mu, this term may be important, right? So in particular, it means that we should actually, the picture looks like this. It's like a quantum mechanical picture, so the quantum field theory effect here is not quite important for understanding what's going on. So potential is always if in the conformal limit the potential is almost zero everywhere and within the certain segment which depends on this ratio dimensionless parameter, but then because the exponential barrier, right, we cannot neglect these terms, right, and we have a two symmetric exponential barrier, but in domain in configuration space where phi is large, we cannot neglect the potential term, but we can replace it by the exponent, and the result we get the Liouville actions. All right. So in this sense, the ultraviolet limit of the Sinch-Gordon model is described in terms of the Liouville theory. And the Liouville theory it's indeed its conformal field theory. It possesses that energy momentum tensors is galomorphic, right? If you, and it has this famous form. It's it's due to the equations of motions. It's okay. Due to the equations of motions, it's galomorphic functions, and we can expand this function in the since we consider the periodic boundary conditions for at least for energy momentum tensor, the coefficients generate the famous Virasoro algebra, and each, as I said before, each term of these expansions. Oops. Good. All right. So each actually each generator integral is turned to be integral of motions is conserved. But they are not commute. This is a not commuting set of integral of motions. Nevertheless, we, as I said, we can, using this generator Ln, we can build the operators which commute with the mutually commute, form the mutually commuting set. And how it works, to build such an operators, we can consider the limit of the integral of motions in Sinch-Gordon model. And as a result, we get the following operators, right, which is built out of energy momentum tensor, galomorphic component of energy momentum tensor. So they look like t is the density, the first density is very simple, t squared, or certain composite field built out of the energy momentum tensor. And if you, this, gives you a set of mutually commuting operators, And in the limit, well, when central charge goes to infinity, the limit C goes to infinity, remember that C involves Q, and which involves B plus 1 over B, so B goes, C goes to infinity means that B goes to 0. So it's a kind of classical limit, so this set actually coincides with the set of the integral of motion, local integral of motion for KdV theory. It's not surprising because they classically KdV and Singe-Gordon model are the same integrable hierarchy, so that is rather predictable. But anyway, we have these operators, and as I said, the density, the corresponding density, built composite. Well, it can be constructed using the T through the operator product expansion, actually regularized operator product expansions. For example, T squared is a regular part of the operator product expansion T and T, and which appeared in first, if you subtract the singular part, you get the operators, and this is definition of T squared. Similarly, you can define T cubed. And this is rather well-defined procedure, how to, this is all the densities are unambiguously defined here. And they can be expressed in terms of the Virasoro generators, right? And, well, expansion modes of the energy momentum tensor. The first one is just L0 up to constant, and then we have the expression like this, which involves the infinite sum. Well, so formally it's not an element of universal enveloping algebra, right? But nevertheless, maybe that looks maybe a little bit confusing because maybe we may have the problem in understanding the infinite sum when we're doing the of the operators. But in this situation, actually, this is not a problem because of the following. So now, if you consider the representations of Virasoro algebra, the highest weight representation characterized by the conformal dimensions delta, and introduce the basis, for example, introduce the basis built out of these modes, it's standard definitions of construction, the basis in the highest weight representations. Then in each level subspaces, and level subspaces we means that it's a graded, space, so the number of modes, the sum of this n modes Ln actually is fixed by the level. And in spite that when we have infinite sum here, right, once this operator acts on the level subspaces, this sum actually truncated. And so the operator, each of this operator acts irreducibly, invariantly within the level subspaces. So in other words, that at each level subspaces, the I, it's just a matrix. The size of the matrix is equal to the dimensions of the level subspaces, which is in general, it's a number of partition of integer n. So that is for any fixed level, this is just a finite matrix, maybe large, right? Of course, if n is large, then of course number of partition very large, but it's still a matrix, and we have a problem of we can explicitly construct these matrices using the definition, and we have a this is just an example illustration. So this for level n we have the only one state, right? So there is no, the matrix is one dimensional, the space is one dimensional. Then at level one we have only one state, right? It's again the matrix is trivial. But in the level 2, the first non-trivial example, it's a level 2 when you have two states, L minus 1 squared and L minus 2. So the integral of motions, it's basically, as I said, for calculation of this matrix on the second level, we can drop all the terms which involve L minus 3 higher than in this sum, in this infinite sum, they survive only the first two terms. And all other actually kill the any state at this level. So that is a just a 2x2 matrix, and we can diagonalize this matrix. And so here's two eigenvectors, you see, and two eigenvalues. So the eigenvalues, as you see, the eigenvalues are kind of algebraic functions of the central charge dimensions and dimensions. Right? And now, so immediate questions occur in this point. So what, how to diagonalize these matrices for high, for the higher level, because matrix becomes very large. And so that is clearly a problem. And so the questions, so the first questions, first natural questions, so for given integrable structure, how to calculate the spectrum of local integral of motions? And I should emphasize at this point, so we consider the particular integrable structure of conformal field theory. In conformal field theory, there is no any integrable structures. And the one which we discussed, which appeared through the certain integrable structure, originally introduced the massive theory, and doing the special short distance limit of this theory, we get some particular basis of state, which diagonalized of the integral of motions. But the matter of fact, we can introduce in the same Virasoro highest weight representation, we can introduce a different integrable structure. For example, in another well-known example of the integrable system, integrable field theory in two dimensions, it's so-called bullet dot model, which looks slightly different than the Sinich-Gordon, because here we have two exponents, but with the different different exponents here, the 2b and minus 4b, right? And again, this is integrable systems. Again, this we can consider the conformal limit, and as a result, we get the set of commuting operator which acts in the same space, but now the set is different than the set of KdV equations, that the quantum KdV integral of motions, they look like this. You know, even spins, well, spins are different, so you see integral, the density, this density is 2, but in KdV we have density t squared, there is no density t squared, it only the t cube appeared the first. And so this operator acts in the same space, in the same space of conformal field theory, but it's another, it's a different integrable structure. And we, for this problem, we also have a, address the questions of diagonalization of that set.
But you fix the representation, right?
Yeah, we just consider the
C and
if we fix delta and C, right?
Anything special happens if the degenerate one?
Yes, of course. There are some, but at this point with the integral of motions, but you see, it's algebraic function. You can, in principle, at least for the for it. It appears, of course, in the context of the field theory, right? On the particular field theory you're talking about. Here we're talking about just a some basic property of representations, one representations. Yes, so that is because all the operator acts on the level subspace invariantly. We can forget about the right chiralities and all other stuff. Okay, so this is some principle. So what we should the main message from this my intro. It's actually almost half of my time, but. There are a variety of integrable structure, not just one. So we just mentioned KdV, bullet dot, there is another a KNS, which includes the famous nonlinear Schrödinger equation. There is another so-called paperclip or sausage integrable structure. But what's important then, once you choose these integrable structures, then with the presence, because of the presence of infinite dimensional algebra of extended symmetry, the problem of diagonalization of local integral of motions can admit the mathematical satisfactory construction formulations in terms of representation theory. It's a well-defined problem. Okay. And now I just explain how to solve the problem of diagonalization of calculation of spectrum of local integral of motions. can be solved. Actually, I explained the solutions. This solution was given by now work with Sasha Zamolochik from Volody Bajanov long time ago. And principle, so descriptions of the spectrum based on, remarkably, it's related to the spectral theory which Leon discussed today. And I'm lucky that he gave a nice introduction in the spectral theory of this operate. And many I'm discussing here, it's actually related, deeply related to what Leon said. And so basically the key ingredient here is differential equations, Schrodinger equations, right? Of this is usual Schrodinger equation, but the potentials Ux. First, if you what's important in this potential, forget about this term first. This is clearly that this potential is just an harmonic three-dimensional oscillators. Parameter alpha is in the case alpha is equal to 1, we have a potential like x squared plus L plus 1 over x squared, right, which is centripetal potentials, three-dimensional oscillators, right? Another case we can consider here that alpha is equal to infinity, for example, then the potential will look like, infinite well potential, which is also example which Leon mentioned in his talk. But anyway, this alpha, anyway, so this is these terms is clear. From the formal, from the mathematical point of view, we have differential equations with one regular singularity at x equals 0 and irregular singularity at x equals infinity. But I also would like to introduce some additional singularities, but very special way, right? So it would contain, so clearly there would be a set of singularities dependent on the set VA. And we impose certain conditions, restrictions on the position of the singularities. And the condition looks like this. It's a set of algebraic equations. And imposing this equation, the meaning of this equation is such that this position satisfies this kind of equation, then the solution, any solution of differential equation, actually be single valued in the vicinity of the singularities. It's very strong restrictions. You see, once you introduce the singularity in the potential, then in general you should get braiding. It's some non-trivial monodromy property of a solution. You can, if the potential has a singularity, even regular singularity, right? The functions, the wave functions, not single valued in the vicinity of the singularity. But imposing this condition that this singularity is single valued. We fix they cannot it requires the fixed fine tuning of the parameters or of the position of such singularities, and this is equations. So of course, it's this equation which describes the condition that singular apparent. It's sometimes such a singularity is called apparent singularities. You see the delta here. It's related to L, to angular momentum term. And the next step, it's a spectral determinant, which was a subject of Leon's talk, right? So clearly, for the potential like this, so this is Ux. So if you consider the potential like this, the potential look like this. So we have only discrete spectrum, right? We can clearly formulate the problem, spectral problem with the EG, it's a spectral it's an energy spectrum for the Schrodinger equation. Well, this is without this additional term. But including this term actually not if change.
So it is self-adjoint, right?
I think so. No. With these terms.
Because you want kind of pay attention.
Yeah. For complex P, for real L, of course, imposing by the conditions, by requiring that certain real values of L certain domain will be self-adjoint. But actually, the spectrum, I'm not quite general. The V is complex numbers here. Right? It's not doesn't look self-adjoint. But anyway, the problem can be introduced, and the because of the presence, the all the singularity. Apparent singularity, the monodromy, you can forget about this the additional insertion and still formulate the same type of problem, like unusual harmonic oscillators. So the central object would be the spectral determinant. Well, and actually this product converges only in the case in alpha greater than 1, but then if alpha is not greater than, smaller than 1, then they need some regularizations. But again, the most important would be the trace identities, which Leon mentioned. Basically, it's useful to consider the large E asymptotic. I consider the energy goes to large. Actually, it's negative, well, at least as was mentioned in Leon talk, right? The spectral determinant admit the expansion of this form. And the coefficients of this expansion, the first coefficient, leading coefficient, doesn't depend on the presence of apparent singularities. It's actually the number, certain number. If you focus on subleading terms of these expansions, right, the structure of general structure looks like this. Then we should actually focus on the coefficient like this, which appeared in the certain powers of the expansions of the spectral determinant, inverse powers. These quantities actually can be, for such a quantity, the trace identity can be written, and they can be calculated in terms of, systematically in terms of using the WQB approximations. Some another coefficients here, but we are actually at this point we interested in the coefficient like this, because the reason we are interested in these coefficients because they exactly the coincide with the eigenvalue of local integral of motions. So the statement which has come from our paper is that if you take these algebraic systems that and identify the delta, it's the same delta as highest weight representation, the central charge related to the to this parameter alpha is to alpha. So this is related to anagamonicity of the potential. And n, it's a level, a number of apparent singularities, it's a level subspaces. Then we conjecture and we check explicitly for just solving this equation for small n, 1, 2, 3, up to 5, I guess, that the number of the solutions of this equation coincide with the number of partitions of integers n, up to, of course, the action of the symmetric group.
So this is an equation for what?
For apparent singularities, for V, right. And this condition just guarantees the potential has apparent singularities, this statement that number of solutions coincide with number of partitions was proven just recently by David Mazaira. Okay, and it means the number of solutions coincide with the number of states at the level subspaces. And we can use these sets to label the states and the level subspaces. And integral of motions can be considered as the functions of this set, of the set of solutions of this set. And the statement was that this coefficient exactly gives the eigenvalues of local integral of motions. Yes.
Possibly one more stupid question. So, like, it continues one of the questions asked before. What if your variable module is degenerate? So, if delta is special, then what happens with the number? Right? Then probably you need a small number of solutions.
No, solution would be the same, but something different would be. Maybe I will mention. Okay. But the number of solutions remain the same. But something, of course, interesting happened. Right. But it's a different story. So here are some explicit formula. For example, each of these functions of this set, it's a symmetric polynomial, of course. It's a symmetric polynomial for order of m minus 1. So in the case of the first integral of motions, the order of the symmetric polynomial is 0, so it's just a number of apparent singularities. For the first not for I3, it would be just a linear symmetric polynomial. It would be linear functions of V. For the next integral of motion, would be quadratic one, that this one, and linear and quadratic terms, and so on. So in other words, in order to find at least the spectrum of the local integral of motions, we need to solve these systems, and then it's done, right? So it's a symmetric polynomial, give the eigenvalue. Of course, this can be checked with direct calculations by diagonalizations of matrix. But together with the local integral of motions, There is another interesting integral of motions, another structure which includes in this integrable structure. It's called non-local integral of motion. It was discussed in our paper a long time ago, again with Sasha and Volodya. And the simplest example of non-local integral of motion is so-called reflection operators. It's among the commuting families, commute with the local integral of motions. And it has many applications. And what's interesting that this reflection operator for the KdV integrable structure is related to the reflectionist matrix in Liouville theory. The matrix was discussed in many works before, but probably the best explanations of this object was given by Sasha and Alyosha in 1996. Yes.
This correspondence that you had before works for any central charge? Or?
Yes, it worked for any central charge.
But you said that alpha is bigger than 1, so then...
It's algebraic equations, and you see when you diagonalize your matrix, it doesn't matter what domain. It can be applied for any values of central charge dimensions. And that's the beauty of this, because you know, don't need to worry about the domain of your parameters. So let me remind you how the Liouville-less matrix works. So again, we return to the Liouville theory, energy momentum. Again, the energy momentum expands the Virasoro algebras. We have the this is our representation in terms of field phi. But now let's think about this again.
Once you finish all these things, and you diagonalize everything, yeah, and you find the right one, at the end you get back your Riemann model.
Yes, I should emphasize, actually the problem at this formulation is a pure algebraic representation theory. We are not going to glue these different chiralities, we just focus on one chirality, actually one level, when everything is it's a well-defined problem in linear algebra. So let's think about this a little bit, what happened with the Liouville theory. And in the case when the phi, again, we consider the domain of configuration space where phi becomes very large but negative. If it's large and negative, then this term, it's negligible, right? And we have just free actions, the theory of free Bose field, and which admits the function d phi, right, would be galomorphic function which can be expanded in the Fourier series of this form, and from the action we read the canonical commutation relation for these oscillators, creating annihilating oscillators, and so in this asymptotic domain, the energy momentum tensors can be expressed in terms of the creating annihilating operators, right? And it looks like this. It's a famous Bosonization formula, Fagan-Fuchs, Zatsenko-Fatyev Bosonization formula for the Virasoro algebra. But remember that we can build representations of the algebra now. It's a Fock space. And as a Fock space, right, so this formula actually provide the a conformal structure of representation of Virasoro algebra of in the Fock space, right? So, and but this Fock space actually, as a linear space, it's isomorphic to the Verma models of Virasoro algebra. So, and the zero mode momentum of the Fock space related to the dimensions of delta. But now it's interesting, the important feature that delta is an even function of p. So in other words, we have two choices which correspond to the same delta with the Fock space with positive p and the negative p. And clearly this can be interpreted just in the spirit of quantum mechanics. We can interpret it as this, as each of these Fock, the basis of the Fock space is a space of asymptotic states. Right, so for positive p, we have a set of in state which considered as a propagations of like a mini superspace approximation. We consider the propagations of the wave which is scattered on the exponential barrier, right? And this Fock space would correspond to the in state, and with the opposite sign, with a negative p, would be reflected out state. Right. Once we have this, such a two spaces, in and out spaces of in and out state, we can introduce this matrix, and so it's a reflectionless matrix, Liouville theory. It has this form, this sum of structures. It contains the sum normalization factor, which is famous normalization factors, which is a contains a lot of information about Liouville theory. But for us, it would be important how these operators, how the reflection this matrix is on. Operated, to be precise, it's not Twiner. It acts between the different Fock spaces. And it's interesting and important, which was emphasized by Sasha and Alyosha, that this intertwiner admits that, first of all, factorized on the right and left chirality, an absolutely independent operator, S bar and S. And each of these operators acts in between, it's intertwined between Fock spaces, chiral part of the S matrix. We normalize such a way to make this one, then all the normalization goes to this factor, right? And what's important that this reflection operator, chiral reflection operators, is chiral S-matrix is fully determined by conformal symmetry. It's quite evident because we, as I said in this theory, the energy momentum tensor, this each of these components is conserved charges, right? So in classical, just think, if you think about the classical, that this quantity would conserve. In principle, what we need to do is solve in a classical level to construct this reflectionless metric. We need to express the oscillators A in terms of ln, inverse this relation, this formula. But in other words, we should solve this equation with respect to phi. This is basically Riccati equations. And in quantum level, this can be formulated as the statement that these operators are ambiguously defined. And the constructions, and then the next idea that having this, if you have this S-matrix, reflectionless matrix, then we can build the operator which commute with the local integral of motions. And it works the following way. Let me emphasize first that these operators acts between the different space, right? Different Fock space. It doesn't have any sense to diagonalize these operators, right? It's intertwiner. But we also can introduce the intertwiner, it's another intertwiner, which acts similarly, but very simple way, just to flip the sign of oscillators. This sign, this I call it set conjugations. And then, if you think about this picture with the Liouville, returning to the Liouville theory and see what happened with the wave, which is, we forget about the left barrier. We consider the scattering on the right barrier, then under the scattering, we get the Fez, which is Liouville S-matrix, dictated by Liouville S-matrix, that then we should go to the right barrier, left barrier again, and find this way the total scattering. If you describe the whole scattering, we need to include the scattering on the two barriers. And but after the scattering, because of identifications of space, we need to introduce this additional set conjugations because it's a flip the sign of phi. But anyway, that principle that the combination like scattering C and this barrier, then we should inverse identify f pi, f minus pi and f pi should insert the reflections. So conjugations, then scattering about this barrier gives us this operator and then back. So the result we may expect that such a combinations of operator which acts now x in the Fock space commute with the local integral of motion.
Sorry, just for precision, sir. This is already an extended Carroll Fock space? Or?
No, it's just a Carroll space. We focus on, well, because we focus only the one chirality, and we focus on one chirality and build this operator, which is, well, you see, this is a squared of operators, right? Clearly, it's a squared. For this reason, I introduced CS, and actually, for just for historical reason, I put minus one. No, doesn't. But what's important, that this operator is now acts in the Fock space, given Fock spaces, and this operator, I call it reflection operator. So it's additional operators. As a matrix, it's very similar to the reflection matrix, but we need to flip the sign somewhere. So construction of the reflection operator is very simple. Indeed, it follows the following way. So we have a Bézignanisations formula like this, but we also we have a Virasoro constructed Virasoro algebra with the same central charge, but if you flip the sign of the background charge Q, right? If you just flip minus here. But of course, it would be different oscillator basis. In other words, in the Fock space, we can introduce three different bases. First of all, Virasoro basis, then the one basis, Fock basis, is built out of operator AM, and another base built out of operator AM bar. But of course, this is a base in the same space, so there is a matrix omega which relates the Gesenberg basis and Virasoro basis, this one, there is a certain matrix. And similar for the tilde basis.
Sorry, but what happens to the labeling?
For the what?
Labeling.
Labeling?
Labeling, yes.
What labeling?
How would you later label?
It doesn't matter, you know, it's just a basis. Let me choose this. This is a set of the basis in the space.
Okay, this is the basis that you choose for the Virasoro generator block and...
You see, it doesn't matter. Actually, what would be interesting for me, it's a basis which relate not this matrix relate the base Virasoro one with the Gesenberg operators, using the same matrix, I can, but also applying the CFT conjugations, I can relate build the matrix which relate the basis the tilde basis with the Virasoro one. And what I'm going to do is just because they're the same, I need the relation between in and out, the tilde and the untilde basis.
Okay, probably he wanted to say that you have to order them, the N1 greater than N2.
Oh, yes, yes, of course. If you order, this should be the basis, right? But finally, what base you use, it doesn't matter. Because finally, what having this, now I'm making equality here. And as a result, I get the matrix which relate the tilde basis. So Virasoro basis here, it's just intermediate step. And you know, the matrix finally, it's hidden in the summation indexes here. And the lesson is that reflection operator is expressed in terms of single matrix. What you need to do is calculate these matrices, choose the sum basis, calculate this matrix, and then build the reflection operator in this way. Yeah, this is the ordering here. It's not well. It should be there just a basis somehow. Some basis how introduced. Okay, that it's not difficult to show now that this operator indeed commutes with the local integral of motion. The main observation based, if you write the energy momentum tensors, it looks like this T, for example, right? It contains the quadratic terms which is invariant with respect to flip of the sign, but it contains also the terms, but this linear term, but these terms is second derivative, which is actually disappeared when you integrate it. And it happened, this miracle happened for all integrals of motions. All of them, when expressed in terms of field phi, actually even function of phi. So they invariant with respect to this flipping the sign. So it doesn't matter, the form of the integral of motion doesn't matter how you what field you used, phi or phi for tilde. And this means actually that this operators, the operator which relate phi bar fields, and phi actually would commute with the local integral of motions. All right, and here is explicit formula, so just illustration for this. And it goes this way. So for example, in the first non-trivial level, it's a second level. In the second level, we have two states, oscillatoric state, right? A minus 1 squared, A minus 2. And this basis, in the Virasoro basis, we have L minus 1 squared and L minus 2. And we can express these states in terms of the oscillatoric using just Bessonization formula, right? So this is gives us the matrix omega. And once you have the matrix omega, you build the matrix of reflection operators. And this reflection is this matrix indeed commute with the local integral of motion, matrix of reflection operators. And so this way we have this problem of that since it's commute, it's equal to zero, right? They can simultaneously diagonalize the reflection operators with the local integral of motions. And since we label the states by these apparent singularities, then the immediate question is what would be the spectrum of, what would be the eigenvalue of the reflection operators? Yes. What would be the eigenvalue of reflection operators? And the answer is rather, again, we should return to the differential equations, so which we start with. But now the subject of our interest would not the sublinear coefficient, but first sublinear coefficient, these terms. You see, this is in expansion, we have something which doesn't depend on state, but the first non-trivial coefficients in the spectral determinant is the one, which is also the one which is probably the main sublinear, which is the main sublinear asymptotic, which depend on the position of apparent singularities, these coefficients. There is no such a some rules, such as trace identities, like and for local integral of motions from the theory of differential equations, so it's more complicated problem. But nevertheless, it's remarkably that so that problem was for a long time. But remarkably, very recently, it was work of Yeremenko and Tarasov, about the theory of Fuchsian differential equation with the three regular singularities and any number of apparent singularity, and they give some beautiful result about the solutions. They present explicit solutions to such as equations, and using the result of Yeremenko and Tarasov and performing the certain limit, we can actually extract these coefficients. And in terms and express, now it's of course it's a certain symmetric function, but well, you know, the results are not so simple, but it is given by a certain determinant involving the determined the involving the apparent singularities, but of course the formula is not particularly transparent. But finally we have explicit formula for the eigenvalues of reflection operators in any states, right? And they again they express in terms of the apparent singularities. Okay, so probably I don't have a time to discuss. The final fact I would like to mention, that if you understand what's going on here, that you can easily construct the reflection operators for many integrable systems. For example, for bullet dot, what should we do? In this case, we have a tool that looks like a Sinch-Gordon by the different exponent. And then, in other words, to construct the reflection operator, we need to take the reflection operator corresponding to this exponent, right? Reflection matrix. But now we should glue it with the reflection operator corresponding to the exponent with the different background charge. And this combination indeed commutes with the local integral of bullet dot, and still can formulate the problem of diagonalization of this. Another example, for example, we can consider the model, this one. This model is a famous, this part of the model is a famous dual representation for black hole, Euclidean black hole. dual fields, and you can think about the Lundrege complex Sinch-Gordon model as a perturbations of Euclidean black hole by the exponential operator, like a Liouville field. And the same story happened here. So for this conformal field theory, there's analog of the reflection operator, the reflection S-matrix. The S-matrix, I call it cigar S-matrix. And so then to build the reflection operator for these integrable systems, we need to accompany this by the reflection operator of the Liouville theory. And then you, indeed you can check that reflection operators commute with the local integral of motion for this model. And interesting that a long time ago, Samson discussed this model well in the representation in black hole, and there was some manipulations with the fast integrals, and finally the conclusion that this model should be somehow equivalent to the Liouville theory. That was some weird, you know, but remarkably that finally what one of the come out, which is of our papers, which I'm not going to discuss, that this reflection matrix for this model for the black hole actually can be expressed in terms of Liouville theory. There is an explicit formula which relates these two S matrix that was basically up to some factors that are almost the same. This is kind of some interesting problem, some interesting long. This problem has a long story, and now you see that indeed some the signals that the theory somehow very deeply relate. All right, okay. I don't have a time to discuss the applications. And so that's my conclusion. I discussed some integrable structures, reflection operators. And also, all of this actually has interesting application to study the scalent limit, to scalent limit of critical lattice systems, integrable spin chains, and the reflection operator is very useful and actually allows one to classify the state in the lattice system, the beta states. Actually, the states which diagonalize all integral of motion, analog of beta states on the lattice. And that gives you a very powerful method to track the scalent limit of each individual beta states. And there are some interesting ideas that maybe the scalent limit of the theory describe the non-compact sigma model, so that story. But it's a different story. Okay, anyway, so once again, happy birthday, Samson.
Questions, comments?
Yes.
I have possibly many questions. How is it on that picture that you showed with the Sinch-Gordon potential, right? You have some long but some finite distance between those two walls. So then I don't quite understand this formula that you have, that the total product of reflection matrices commutes with local integrals.
Yes.
Is it approximate in
for the basically the
is it exact or what?
Good. That's a good point. Yes. That is that was a in principle in my transparency as a part of my discussions, but you see that indeed we consider that just apply this quantization condition for this mode, zero mode, and naively in the zero order of approximation we just can replace this potential by the infinite well potential, so the quantization condition, like the length of or the total length of the well multiplied by p, which is a multiplied by p is proportional to the integers, right? It's quantization condition for the allowed values of p, and then you should take into account the effect of scattering, right? The phases which is gained on the tuning points, and Sasha and Alyosha Zamolochik of 95 proposed the following equations, asymptotic equations, which involve basically the reflection operators, right? Actually, there was some kind of mistake in their papers, because they say that S matrix commute but this is not S matrix reflection operator, because it's S matrix acts in different spaces. But basically, the the quantization condition for P, it looks like this, right? And in principle, now you can take the in the short distance ultraviolet behavior, you can express the quantization condition. If you know the spectrum of refraction operator, you can write this quantization for each levels. Now, what next? Suppose we solve these equations. Then when actually we should take the, remember that the KdV equation would be polynomial with respect to P, and now we should substitute to solutions of the functions of the distances of the R. And what we get, again, the value of integral of motions out up to the power law correction. So these quantization conditions actually account all logarithms. But the power laws, of course, it's out of the, it's some approximations.
So it's some kind of WK, kind of well-developed WK.
Yes, in the case of the similar can be done for modified Singh-Gordon equations and the Leon told us about the quantization condition in this case. But in that case, it was exact. But here we have a power law, certainly it's up to the, but accuracy of this approximation is rather good, and Fedya knows very well because he studied for many integrals.
I thought I spoke well.
Yeah, because it's actually numerically it's very good. It gives a rather good accuracy.
Professor?
So, in the case of cigar, in the actual black hole thinking, so there were some restrictions on numbers to get central charge 26 or something. So it was a specific coefficient. Parameters were fixed, right?
Yes, yes.
So does it matter in...
You see, in this point, as I said, if you take a look on the formulas here, we should diagonalize this matrix. This parameter Q you're talking about, right? It should fix somehow. But you see, this is functions, which is algebraic function. Actually, it's a function of Q, it's a meromorphic. It's function of B, it's a meromorphic function. You can set any numbers there. This matrix, of course, there's some miracle, some interesting.
But I think the map that we did with Martinek was specific to what?
Yeah, that is another point, because I talk about the general relations. And for these particular values, I don't know what happened, but the relation exists for any background charge, right? And this is just algebraic relation because it's a relation between the matrices. You check it at level by level, and you see that is.
I have a question.
Yes.
Blue dot. Eliminator 3x3.
And this is another Karepin, Izergin Karepin.
The Armadillo 9x9 and construction of algebraic Betanzas is a headache. Can you simplify the construction of algebraic Betanzas?
It's a good point. You're talking about Izergin Karepin model, probably. Right?
Bullet dot.
Bullet dot on like a Singh Gordon. You know, this is a complex. This is. The complex.
You mentioned spin chains.
Yeah, I mentioned a spin chain. There certainly, I don't know. So, I don't know the answer for this problem. But now there we have there is some certain progress in this, but the full answer is still right. Still. Well, at least for me, it's I don't know.
Okay.